Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَوْلَا. And how come? Why not? إِذْ سَمِعْتُمُوهُ. When you heard it, قُلْتُمْ. You said, مَا يَكُونُ لَنَا أَن نَتَكَلَّمَ بِهَذَا. It is not for us to speak of this. Why did you not say at that time, when you heard about that rumor, that مَا يَكُونُ لَنَا أَن نَتَكَلَّمَ بِهَذَا, that it is not appropriate for us, it does not befit us, that we speak of such things, that we speak about vulgar things, about pious people without any evidence. And why did you not say, سُبْحَانَكَ هَذَا بُهْتَانٌ عَظِيمٌ. Glorified are you, O Allah, this is a great slander, this is a great accusation. Why subhanaka? Out of ta'ajjub, out of amazement. That when you hear something that's very shocking, what do you say? Subhanallah. Or you say astaghfirullah. So why did you not say subhanaka hadha buhtanun azim? But why subhanaka and not subhanallah? Because subhanaka, glorified are you, O Allah, that something like this should happen in the house, in the family of your Prophet. Glorified are you, O Allah, that something like this should happen in the family members of your Prophet. This is a great accusation. Buhtan is from the root letters bahata and bahata, buhita. What does it mean? To be shocked, to be astonished, and as a result of that become speechless. That a person is unable to say anything. He's so shocked. And buhtan from that is used for a slander, accusation. Because when an innocent person is accused, it makes him speechless. He's unable to say anything. So you should have said, هَذَا بُهْتَانٌ عَظِيمٌ. So this is the solution which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving to us when we hear backbiting. When we hear another believer being defamed, another believer being spoken ill of. That we should say, what should we say? That مَا يَكُونُ لَنَا أَن نَتَكَلَّمَ بِهَذَا. It's not right for us to say such things. It does not suit a believer to say such things, to talk about such vulgar things, to talk about such negative things. We shouldn't be talking about this. مَا يَكُونُ لَنَا. It's not right for us. It does not befit us. It's not permissible. And besides, this is a great accusation. You see, a person, he is recognized by what he speaks about. Whatever a person talks about, whatever he generally talks about, that is how he is recognized. Isn't it so? That is the image that he develops in front of people. And a true believer, it does not befit him that he should talk about scandals, that he should talk about the mistakes of others, that he should talk about such things that, oh, there's, you know, so-and-so committed zina, and there's an affair going on between so-and-so. No, it does not suit a believer to say something like that. We will learn in the following ayat that al-khabisatu lil-khabisi. That khabis statements, they suit who? Khabis people. And wal-khabisuna lil-khabisat. Wal-tayyibat lil-tayyibin. And pure, good statements, who do they suit? Good people. So if a person is good, if a person is believer, he can never talk about such vulgar things. It does not suit him. And these statements, they were lies. And they were causing hurt to the Prophet ﷺ. And they were causing hurt to his family. And remember that Aisha radhiyallahu anha was very beloved to him. So this was not only a lie, it was buhtan. It would cause grief to the Prophet ﷺ. And when the Prophet ﷺ is upset, you think Allah will not be upset? Of course He would be. We learn in Surah Al-Ahzab, ayah 57, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يُؤْذُونَ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ لَعَنَهُمُ اللَّهُ فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ وَأَعَدَّ لَهُمْ عَذَابًا مُهِينًا. That indeed those people who abuse Allah and His Messenger, Allah has cursed them in this world and the hereafter, and He has prepared for them a humiliating punishment. And if a bad thought does ever come to your mind about someone, why do you have to say it? Why do you have to publicize it? Keep it to yourself. And besides, you should be thinking positively about others. So when you hear something like this, when other people are saying negative things about someone, you should stop them, you should tell them, it does not suit us that we should talk about such things. It is not allowed for us to talk about such things. Just recently, two people were having a conversation and one person was going to talk about someone and the other person stopped them immediately and they said, would you say this in front of them? Would you say this in front of them? And then she reflected for a moment and she said, yeah, I think I would. Or something like that, she said. But basically what I really liked, and she appreciated the fact that the other person stopped her. What I liked over there was that someone had the guts to stop them immediately before they would continue, so that they would remember. Because many times what happens, we don't remember, we don't realize. Isn't it so? We don't realize. So when you hear something like that, say, مَا يَكُونُ لَنَا أَن نَتَكَلَّمَ بِهَذَا. We're not allowed to say such things. Stop them immediately. Generally, what do we think? The other person is backbiting, we're listening and we're saying, she's backbiting. This is what we do, isn't it? We don't stop them. We just think evil about them in our hearts. We don't even stop them. Whereas if we are listening to them, then we are approving. We are putting our share in that conversation. So be very careful. The moment the other person starts, stop. And many times we enjoy listening to such things as well. Just put yourself in the other person's shoes. Would you like that somebody would talk about you in that manner? Or say something like that about you? You wouldn't like it. Yes, unfortunately. That once she said this to somebody that, you know, we shouldn't be talking about this. So they said, this is the topic of our gathering. This is what we talk about. If we don't talk about this, we have nothing to talk about. This is the sign of who? People who are losers. People who are losers. They have nothing good to talk about. You know, that statement that small minds talk about people, average minds talk about events, and great minds talk about ideas. So think about what mind do you have? Which category do you belong to? Are you just talking about people? She said this, she went here, she did this, the baby did that. This is what we're doing, right? Talking about people all the time. Or is it events? I went there and I saw that. So and so went to that event. Such and such thing happened. Or are we talking about ideas? Let's do this. Let's start this. What do you think about this? Think about it. What category do you belong to? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَعِظُكُمُ اللَّهُ. Allah warns you. يَعِظُكُمُ اللَّهُ. يَعِظُ from the root letters, وَاوْ عَيْنْ وَعْظُ. Allah warns you. He admonishes you. And over here it gives a meaning of that He forbids you. أَن تَعُودُ that you ever return لِمِثْلِهِ to the like of this أَبَدًا ever. He's warning you that you ever return to such behavior again. That you ever speak about rumors, you ever spread rumors, you ever talk about scandals again. He's warning you. أَن تَعُودُ لِمِثْلِهِ أَبَدًا إِن كُنْتُم مُؤْمِنِينَ if you're truly believers. What does it mean by that? If you're believers, then you better have learned from this mistake of yours. And you better not repeat this mistake again. In kuntum mu'mineen. Staying away from such type of conduct, from such type of indecent and vulgar conversations, staying away from them is a requirement of iman. Because Allah says, in kuntum mu'mineen. If you're believers. If you're a believer, you better learn from this mistake. Because a believer does not get harmed by the same mistake again. He does not fall into the same error again. Once he falls into a mistake, he learns from it and he avoids it for the rest of his life. So if you're truly believers, you better have learned from this. Now, although this command was given to the Prophet ﷺ, the same command also applies to us. That it's perhaps okay to make a mistake once out of ignorance, that a person does not know the reality of what he's doing, the gravity of what he's engaging in. It could be out of forgetfulness. Once it may happen, but twice it cannot happen. Again and again it cannot happen. And also that it does not befit us that we talk about other people in a negative way, that we talk about especially the Prophet ﷺ and his family, his wives in a negative way. Because the Sahaba are being corrected over here. Never make this mistake again. Never talk about the family of the Prophet ﷺ negatively again. Never accuse his wife ever again. So the same goes for us as well. We're not allowed to speak negatively about the Prophet ﷺ, about his wives, about his family. But unfortunately, there are people who insult the wives of the Prophet ﷺ. They have fabricated stories against them, which are absolute lies, humiliating them, insulting them. There is no righteousness in that. It goes against the teachings of the Quran and Sunnah. And in also day-to-day life, we're not allowed to ascribe lies to people, blame them, accuse them of things that we have no evidence for. And what happens sometimes? That if you hear about someone that they have done something, you want to investigate yourself, and you interfere in their private matters. You go check their call history, you go check their text messages, you go check their email. This is not correct. When a person has a private matter, a private affair, we're not allowed to interfere in such things. So be very, very careful. And remember that a person who has a purpose in his life, who has something important to do, he doesn't have time for such things. He has no interest and he has no time to talk about other people, to investigate their private affairs, to look into their private affairs. It does not suit a believer to do that, especially a believer who has something very important to do in his life. وَيُبَيِّنُ اللَّهُ لَكُمُ الْآيَاتِ And Allah makes clear to you the verses. وَاللَّهُ عَلِيمٌ حَكِيمٌ And Allah is knowing and He is wise. Allah clarifies the ayat to you, the commands, the prohibitions, the etiquette, the manners. He has clarified all of them to you, especially those that can be learned from this incident and also otherwise. وَاللَّهُ عَلِيمٌ He is knowledgeable. All of the commands and prohibitions that He has given to you, they're based on His knowledge. And He is Hakim. They're also based on His wisdom. We listen to the recitation of these ayat. Let's continue. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يُحِبُّونَ Indeed, those people who like أَن تَشِيعَ الْفَاحِشَةُ That immorality should spread فِي الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا In those people who believe For such people لَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ For them is a painful punishment in this world and also in the hereafter. وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ And Allah knows and you do not know. Over here in this ayah, the punishment is being mentioned for those people who try to spread immorality, for those people who try to spread indecency. And how do they spread indecency? By talking about indecent things, by talking about scandals. يُحِبُّونَ أَن تَشِيعَ الْفَاحِشَةَ Tashi'a is from the root letters Sheen Ya'ain. And Sha'a Yashi'u literally means to spread, when something becomes publicized. From the same root is the word Sha'a Al-Khabr, meaning the Khabr, the news, it spread and it gained popularity, it gained a lot of importance. Isha'a, which means publication, right? So when a book is published. So those people who love, who want, that تَشِيعَ الْفَاحِشَةُ Indecency should spread amongst those people who believe. فَاحِشَة is used for that which is indecent, but primarily it is used for any action, any word, any medium, anything through which someone's sexual desire is aroused. Their sexual desire is stirred up. It could be some kind of conversation. It could be a movie that they're watching. It could be some literature, some book that they're reading. It could be some music that they're listening to. Anything, the result of which is that when the other person comes across it, his sexual desire is aroused. This is what fahisha primarily is. And from this, fahisha is used for an action that is immoderate, an action that is beyond limits, that is excessive, an action that is evil, whose evil affects other people as well, improper conduct, an abhorrent crime, something that is very shameful. And in the Quran, the word fahisha is used in several ways. It is used for zina. It is used for homosexuality. It is used for nudity, lewdness. It is also used for a scandal. So the word fahisha is used in several ways. So those people who want that fahisha should spread in those people who believe. So what do they want basically? That zina should become common. That nudity should spread. People should not have any haya left. Women should not have any haya left. That scandals should spread. That people should watch such things. They should listen to such things. They should talk about such things that are constantly arousing their sexual desire. And when that is happening, obviously, people who are not married, what's going to happen to them? They're going to end up committing zina. They're going to end up looking for the one whom they like, because that's what they watch in TV shows. That's what children have been watching since they opened their eyes, in cartoon movies. That so-and-so gets together with the one whom they love, and then they live happily ever after. And this is what every child is looking for from the very beginning. Just think about it. All those movies that you watched when you were a child, what are they all about? Love stories, aren't they? To summarize, they're love stories. So this is how fahisha spreads. That from a very, very young age, sexual desires of children even, they're awakened. Children who do not have any idea. I remember once, there was this little girl whom I saw, she was watching a particular Disney movie. And the girl was dressed up in a way that her dress was, you know, very low-necked, and her shoulders were being exposed, and it looked like a very lovely dress. And this little girl, 5 or 6 year old, she did was that she unzipped her dress from behind, her frock, and she lowered the neck part so that her shoulders would be exposed. And so that her dress becomes like the dress that she's looking at in the cartoon movie. And I was shocked that this is the effect that this has even on little children. فِي الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا Innocent minds are corrupted. Innocent minds. That this is what they think is cool. And as children grow up, whatever they're given to see, whatever they're given to read, this is what it's all about. Fahisha. And it doesn't stop there. As people grow older, as they become adults even, even when they're married and they want to buy a car and they go to a dealership, there is a woman who is wearing scandalous clothes, the way she's talking to you, as if she's flirting, not realizing that you have white hair on your head and you have a son with you who's also an adult, perhaps you have your wife with you, and there she's coming talking to you as if she wants to go out with you. This is fahisha. If a car has to be advertised, if a particular food has to be advertised, if something has to be advertised, what is used? Women. If some food has to be, some ingredient has to be advertised, some love affair has to be shown. Isn't it so? If you look at magazines, if you look at newspapers, if you look at TV, this is what's going on. Fahisha, fahisha, fahisha. So those people who want that fahisha should spread among believers. That there is a society, there is a community, there are people who are believers, who are decent, who lower their gaze, the women cover, the men they look down, people are married, people are chaste, they don't mingle with the opposite gender, they keep to their own matters and concerns, they don't interfere with other people. They want that this should change. They want that the society should be changed, that men and women should be able to mingle together with one another. They should be able to talk freely with one another. That women should not have to cover themselves, and men should have the confidence to look up to the women whom they are speaking to. And that there should be advertisements in which they are women. This is what they want. What does Allah say? For such people, there is adabun. There is punishment. There is a severe punishment for such people who want that haya should be removed from the Muslim society. Now, how was haya being removed in the Muslim society of that time? How? By talking about a scandal. By talking publicly about zina. Because when this happens, when you can dare to speak about such things in your gatherings, in your casual conversations, so-and-so slept with so-and-so, what does that lead to? Indecent conversations. Indecency. Immorality. Fahisha. But remember that this fahisha, this is from who? From shaitan. Because we have learned in the Quran that it is shaitan who commands fahisha. In Surah Al-Baqarah, ayah 268, we learn, أَشْشَيْطَانُ يَعِدُكُمُ الْفَقْرَ وَيَأْمُرُكُمْ بِالْفَحْشَى. Shaitan threatens you with poverty and orders you to do immorality. And fahisha is haram on believers. In Surah Al-A'raf, ayah 33, we learn, قُلْ إِنَّمَا حَرَّمَ رَبِّيَ الْفَوَاحِشَ مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا وَمَا بَطَنَ. that say that my Lord has forbidden fawahish, the apparent of it and also the hidden of it. And when the believers do come across fahsha, then what is their behavior? They avoid it. They stay away from it. They repent from it. We learn in Surah Ash-Shura, Ayah 37, وَالَّذِينَ يَجْتَنِبُونَ كَبَائِرَ الْإِسْمِ وَالْفَوَاحِشِ. Those who avoid the major sins and they also avoid fawahish, immoralities. They don't like to talk about indecent things, about love affairs, about scandals. In Surah Al-Qasas, Ayah 55, we learn, وَإِذَا سَمِعُوا اللَّغْوَ أَعْرَضُوا عَنْهُ. Whenever they hear lagh, they turn away from it. وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنِ اللَّغْوِ مُعْرِضُونَ. Because this is lagh, right? Talking about indecent things, talking about scandals, this is indecent. So the believers, they do not have any interest in fawahish. They stay away from it. Why? Because they know that Allah has forbidden it. Whether it is in the form of a TV show, or it is in the form of some literature, or it is in the form of some movie, in the form of the conversations that people have, the believer cannot have any interest in this. He cannot have any interest in this. You see, whatever a person watches, whatever a person reads, that becomes a part of him. Whatever a person takes interest in, that becomes a part of his conversation. So a believer does not like fahisha. He stays away from it. And those people who want that fahisha should spread among believers, for them is a severe punishment. وَلَوْلَا فَضْلُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ وَرَحْمَتُهُ. And if it had not been for the favor of Allah and His mercy, وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ رَؤُوفُ الرَّحِيمُ. And because Allah is kind and merciful, had it not been for this, then surely Allah would have hastened to bring about your punishment. The end of this clause has not been mentioned for greater effectiveness. Because if you notice, وَلَوْلَا فَضْلُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ وَرَحْمَتُهُ وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ رَؤُوفُ الرَّحِيمُ, then what? The conclusion has not been mentioned. Why? For greater effectiveness. That had it not been for the mercy of Allah, then Allah would have hastened the punishment on you. You would have been in great trouble. You would have been duly punished. But it's out of the favor of Allah, out of His mercy, that Allah has saved you. It is out of His mercy. So, taking these two ayat, what do we learn? That fahsha is something that a believer cannot have any interest in. He does not talk about it. He does not spread it. He does not like that other people should be talking about it. And whenever he comes across it, he avoids it. And he discourages other people from talking about such things as well. So for example, looking at it practically, you're sitting with your friends and there she is talking about a love story that she read. What are you going to do? So what happened then? Right? No. This should not be your way, because then you're participating in spreading the fahisha. And the one who spreads the fahisha, for him is severe punishment. Similarly, if there's something coming on TV and it arouses sexual desire, perhaps the dress that the woman is wearing, perhaps the words, perhaps the conversation that is taking place, perhaps the whole story, perhaps the whole theme of that program, of that television show. If it is such, you cannot watch it. You cannot let other people watch it. You cannot have any interest in this. Because this is spreading fahisha. This is being a part of spreading fahisha. Because just imagine if a person is, you know, watching a show in which there is haram. And let's say you watched it, your friend watched it. And you know that it comes on a particular day. Let's say on Wednesdays it comes in the evening. And you meet your friend on Thursday. Did you see it? Oh my God. Can you imagine what happened? This is what? Tashir al-fahisha. Spreading fahisha. It's not permissible. It's not right. So you understand now? Practically, you cannot have any interest in fahisha. You cannot talk about it. You cannot spread it. And if anything is like this, that it arouses a sexual desire in whatever form, in whatever medium, you cannot like it. And remember that if you watch it, if you talk about it, if you listen to it, then it's going to become so simple, so easy. It's not going to remain a big deal. When zina is something so reprehensible, something so bad, that look at the punishment, flog the people who engage in this act 100 times and don't have any affection for them. How can we like such things? How can we watch them? How can we talk about them? How can we be proud of the fact that I've watched the entire series? It's not something to be proud about. Because if you watch it, it's going to come into your conversations. If it will come in your conversation, if it comes into the actions, not a big deal anymore. Unfortunately, we don't consider such things to be haram, but look at what is mentioned over here. Adabun alim, painful punishment. And for something for which punishment is threatened, that is definitely haram. So engaging in fahisha in any way, watching it, talking about it, listening to it, does not suit a true believer. ما يكون لنا أن نتكلم بهذا. It does not suit us. Again, don't talk about it. Like for example, if you go outside, it's summertime, you see a lot of fahisha, you hear a lot of fahisha, you don't have to go back home and tell your sister about how you saw that girl dressed and describe her in full detail. No. You saw it, say astaghfirullah, lower your gaze, go to your work, get back inside. Simple. But when you see it, then don't go on talking about it. Because when you start talking about it, that is when fahisha will spread. You're not allowed to spread it. You understand? You're not allowed to propagate it. Recitation? Let's listen to the recitation of these verses from the beginning. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته